lifted high over the clouds up into the blue sky. Hearts open wide, hands lifted high over the clouds up into the blue sky. Hearts open wide, hands lifted high over the clouds up into the blue sky. Hearts open wide, hands lifted high over the clouds up into the blue sky. You will never run away, you're forever mine. You will never run away, you're by my side. You will never run away, you forever shine.
Final exam schedule. Here are the do's and don'ts for finding when your final exams take place. Two, go online and look at the MySAU website. Select academics at the top of the site. Once the academics page is loaded, look to the right of the page in the calendars and schedules section. Scroll to the bottom of the section and click Fall 23 Final Exam Schedule. Now you have your own final exam schedule on your device. Don't go to the student feed on the Spring Arbor app and ask when finals are. But nobody has time for 15 students asking about the schedule in a day. Do look around your dorm building or the group chat with your dorm hall. Your RAs usually post the exam schedule for you. Don't shred the physical copy of the schedule if one is given to you or if you print one out. I shouldn't have to explain this to you, but it's happened. What did I just say? Do check the Student Life page on the Spring Arbor app. Sometimes it's posted there, but it is still more reliable to check the MySAU website, so keep that in mind. Don't space out or sleep during this tape. This message is very... Hey, are you paying attention? I see you sleeping down there. And you three, stop talking and listen to what I'm saying.
Okay, so are we all in agreement that we're gonna watch Bluey?
I'd rather watch Teen Titans.
I like Rugrats.
We could watch Avatar The Last Airbender.
Oh, I want to watch Powerpuff Girls.
I don't care what we watch, as long as we're eating the best cereal in the world.
No. Lucky Charms is the superior cereal in the world.
If you like eating styrofoam...
Okay, I'm just gonna make the call. We're watching Bluey.
What? No! No, wait, I want to watch Powerpuff Girls!
Stop it!
It's beautiful, isn't it? Another job well done.
I like VeggieTales.
What's wrong, Cap?
Yes,
our careers are going nowhere, Millward.
But our work is up all...
As the semester comes to a close, the music department has many different concerts coming up. The first is the Winter Instrumental Concert, which will highlight our jazz band and concert band. Then, on that same week, we have the Winter Choral Concert that will include music from our gospel choir and chamber choir. Come join us at White Auditorium for some fun nights with our music students to celebrate all of their hard work. Can't wait to see you all there. And songwriters, the Babbie Mason Songwriting Competition is coming up. If you have an original song that you would like to enter, send in an MP3 or MP4 file of your song and scores by December 15th. You can submit these files to this email address. If you are selected as a finalist, there will be a live competition on February 9th in the RCF featuring a special performance from Babbie herself. We can't wait to hear all of your songs.
Spiritual Life Retreat is approaching, so now is the time to sign up. This retreat is a time to rest and to get close to the Lord. It costs $10 to sign up, and there are limited slots, so make sure you scan the QR codes around campus. We are so excited to experience this retreat with you guys.
Hello, Spring Arbor University community. My name is Kayla Knapp, and I'm a 2012 alum of SAU and the current Dean of Students. I'm delighted to be sharing a little bit with you this Advent season, which is my most cherished time of the church calendar. I think the reason I love Advent so much is because it tunes our hearts, eyes, and ears to be ready waiting, and expecting Christ to show up. I imagine when you hear that, you may find yourself reflecting on the saints of old who were waiting for the arrival of their Messiah. After all, we are celebrating the Christmas season. Or perhaps your heart goes to the future as we look forward to the beautiful day Jesus returns and begins to bring about a new heaven and redeemed earth where all of life's suffering ceases. Both of these are absolutely part of this season. But more than anything, what I think I'm captivated by is the middle, the space where we currently operate. This season could be dull, dreary, and full of impatience. But when you take a look at this week's readings, you catch a glimpse of a couple things. First, we are reminded in Isaiah 40 that though the grass fades and the flowers fall, the word of God is eternal. We see in other passages throughout this Advent season that Jesus is the Word made flesh. And in this week's reading in Mark chapter 1, we are told what we can expect from this word, that he would baptize us with the Holy Spirit, to know and root in our hearts the fact that Christ, the Word of God, is eternal and baptizes those who believe in the Holy Spirit, means we celebrate the past works of God. We anticipate the ultimate redemption of all things, and we move by the power of the deposited Holy Spirit within us. We are meant to walk in step with the Spirit, becoming vessels of all that Jesus encompassed during his time on earth. When we move and show up, we participate in the incarnation, which helps us see the kingdom showing up here. So, let us look for God's hand daily and move in a way that brings more of heaven everywhere we go. Indeed, Christ is eternal. May our faithful obedience in the present become the vehicle through which the eternal word lives and moves to the glory of God.
Amen. Amen. Thanks, Kayla, for that good word. If you want to follow along with the readings for Advent, you can open up your journal and look at the top pages of the dates for December, and there's both the dates listed, but then you can link to a QR code through the QR code to our webpage for the Advent series. Well, good morning. Welcome to chapel. Good to have you here today, this last beginning of the last full week of the fall semester. I'm sure you're anxious about what's happening next week with finals and ending of the semester. So we will all just be patient for these days as we prepare for not just finals week, but as Kayla has mentioned, we prepare for celebrating Christmas this season. Just one thing that didn't make the announcements because we weren't sure of where things were going to land. You may have seen the email this morning that our women's soccer team is playing in the semifinals. Today at 3 p.m., we'll have a watch party in the Cougar Den, so come on out, support your sports. We look forward to them winning, beating Cumberland's, and then playing tomorrow for the championship. So today, we get to hear from a leader of the Free Methodist Church. Dr. Julie Durbin serves as the worship leader at her church in New Brighton, Pennsylvania. She also teaches humanities at worship at Northeastern, and she teaches humanities in another school in Pennsylvania that I can't remember. But she comes today to talk about calling, vocation, our life work, and kind of following our theme in being called to more. And she's had a unique journey through understanding her calling as she has served as a missionary overseas with Ukraine, as she served her local church, and now as she serves as a teacher and professor. So I'm excited about this message for us as we think about how we are called to more as we serve in our careers. So we're going to pray for her after worship, as we always do, but right now Eli Nelson is going to come and lead us in our call to worship. Would you please stand with me?
Good morning. Our call to worship today is from Luke chapter 11, verses 1 through 4, and it reads this. One day Jesus was praying in a certain place, And when he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. And Jesus said to them this, when you pray, say, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Let's worship together.
Salvation, one doorway that leads to life, one redemption, one confession. I believe in the name of Jesus Christ. I believe in the crucifixion. By his blood I have been set free. I believe in the resurrection. Hallelujah, his life is destined. For me, far beyond what hearts imagine, ears have heard or eyes have seen. I believe that the day is coming. He's returning to claim his bride. Light the altar, keep it burning.
Holy Spirit, our God. calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same thing for me. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you. Of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm calling on the God of Mary, whose favor rests upon the all things are possible. I'm calling on the God of David, who made a shepherd boy courageous. I may not face Goliath, but I've got my own giant. So God, my God, I need you. Prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing then. You are providing now. My God, I need you.
standing on your faithfulness, on your faithfulness. I'm calling on the Holy Spirit.
I'm holding on to your truth. I won't take a single step till I hear your voice. I surrender. And when my eyes cannot see, it's your through the night. I won't move until you speak. when my eyes cannot see, it's your voice that's leading me out of darkness and into light. It's your
anyone who would like to come forward and pray over her, and I invite you to do so now. Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. Yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Thank you, Lord, for your servant who has come to give us a message, Lord, that you have laid on her heart, and I pray that your voice would be the only voice we hear today. God, that your light is breaking through the night, and we will not move until you speak. Because you are here in this place, and you are working and moving in power in the only way that you can. We thank you for your goodness today. We love you, Lord, and we will be careful to give you all the praise and honor and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
What a privilege it is to be here with you today. A friend of mine that I work with at Geneva College has taught me to say, "The Lord be with you." And what sometimes is said back is, "And also with you." And what that is a return of the blessing. So would you do that for me? The Lord be with you. Thank you. Because we need the Lord with us today. So my name is Julie Durbin. I'm an adjunct professor at Geneva College in Western Pennsylvania. It's a small RP school. It's affiliated with the Reformed Presbyterian Church of North America. Meanwhile, I'm a lifelong Free Methodist. I teach writing and humanities there. And I also lead worship at my church, at the New Brighton Free Methodist Church. My husband also teaches, but his primary vocation is to write. He's a writer, a published novelist of fantasy and speculative fiction. As my friend who married us says, how fun of God to put us together. We got married just 10 years ago when I was 37 and he was 47. I think God had something to do with it because Fred was born in Illinois. I was born in Pennsylvania. After college, Fred moved to Japan, where he lived and worked for 22 years, and I moved to Ukraine, where I lived and worked for 10 years. I moved back to the U.S. in 2010. Fred moved back to the U.S. in 2011 and relocated to Pittsburgh just in time to meet me. God has his ways of taking care of us, even when we choose some strange and unique paths in life. But I'm not here to talk about romance, at least not specifically. Spring Arbor, I have been thinking about you for a few months now, and as this date approached, what I've been thinking about the most is, what is a freshman thinking about in December? What is a senior thinking about in December? And don't worry, juniors and seniors, I'm thinking about you too, juniors and sophomores. I've been teaching college students now for about 12 years, and I find that what it does to me is every semester I relive the college experience. I think about what it was like to come as a freshman and what I felt. And as I get older, I start to live the experience of a parent. I'm not a parent, but I'm the age of the people who are leaving their children in the hands of institutions like yours. So if you don't mind, I'd like to take you back today to what my students call the 1900s. In the fall of 1994, I was a freshman at Roberts Wesleyan College in Rochester, New York. I was full of hopes and dreams. By the first night, I had just barely gotten my bed made. That's all I managed to do. I didn't move in. My roommates were moving in. They were filling up the room. All I managed to do was just like barely get my bed made. And I'd been hopping up and down on this chair that was precariously teetering on a shag carpet. And the last time I hopped up there, it failed me. And I landed on my face and smashed my glasses into my head. It was a great start to a new year. But I was okay. And I started the year wanting to be known and loved, wanting to find my place in the world. Freshman orientation was filled with activities taken right out of a children's show on Nickelodeon. You know, Dizzy Bat, running through Jell-O, good stuff like that. That was really big in the 90s. I stood to the side making snarky comments and laughing with my brand new friend, Nancy Carter, laughing so hard that my sides hurt that night. We were roommates by the end of that first year and have been friends since. As a college student, I really had no idea what I wanted to be when I grew up. I did know that I wanted to do something meaningful and creative. I got registered as undecided, but before I knew it, someone had made me a double major in art and music. I knew I didn't want to do education. Who would want to teach? And I'd seen what music and art teachers go through in K through 12, and I didn't have any idea what college teaching looked like. But then things changed for me when I met Dr. Elvira Berry, a formidable dark-haired woman with a magnetic, perceptive gaze. She directed the honors program and taught the honors writing class called Principles of Writing, POW. Some people called it Prisoners of Writing. Now I teach such courses. When I started to journal about my hopes and fears for the future, she invited me to meet with her, and before long, I had found a new major, hers, communication. In the communication program, I could pursue any number of careers. It felt like a wide open door of possibility instead of a tunnel leading to one or two unlikely options. And at Roberts, the chair of the communication department also taught classes in dramatic reading and German literature. It was the right place for me. Even though I dropped the arts majors, I still kept drawing and painting and making nativity figures out of clay. I kept taking voice lessons and singing in the Roberts Wesleyan Chorale. One of my best memories was singing with that chorale when we performed with the Rochester Philharmonic, and I got to sing a couple of solo lines in Hebrew from Bloch's Sacred Service. I might have changed my major, but I could still be a singer. But I also remember one night after a fancy piano concert. It might have been the first year of our brand new, spanking fresh, state-of-the-art auditorium at Roberts. I went home from the concert super depressed, knowing I will never be a great musician now. I had chosen a different path. And despite my best efforts and wishes, I couldn't actually take all the paths at once. How is an 18-year-old to choose a path for life? How is a 22-year-old? How is a 47-year-old? On one hand, you can live a good life no matter what. The road is always open, and God is always God. Let God guide your life, and life can be good. On the other hand, every choice we make comes with consequences. I remember a conversation I had after class with another communication professor. He'd given students a choice. He said, if you just want to see, you don't have to do this and this. If you just want a B, you can skip the final project. If you want a shot on an A, you have to do everything. I was a stressed out junior at the time, preparing my junior vocal recital, and I had to make a judgment call. I just was not going to be able to do everything, and I definitely couldn't do everything well. So I explained to my professor that I was going to bail out on my Gaelic project for linguistics class. I'd take the B. He was bummed and told me, you know, one of these days you're going to have to choose something. I still remember what I said. I wouldn't be here right now if I were that kind of person. My goodness, is that ever an explanation for my life? I wouldn't be here right now if I were the kind of person who could just choose one thing. But choosing several things at once can be really overwhelming. It's probably why one of my favorite chapters in the Bible is 1 Corinthians 1. I think it was in my sophomore year that this chapter became really meaningful to me. I was learning so much, and if you take up the habit of learning, what you soon discover is the more you learn, the more you realize what you don't know, and the more you realize what is unknowable and beyond your grasp. So I was trying to wrap my head around my life sitting in my dorm room, and I read the beginning of Paul's letter to the Corinthians, starting with verse 18. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise. The intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached, to save those who believe. Jews demand miraculous signs, and Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not, to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God, that is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. God knew I needed to hear this. Perhaps he knew that my relationship with the pursuit of wisdom in an academic sphere was going to last more than 4 years. All I know is that in the moment, I really needed to hear these words. I needed to remember that God's wisdom was beyond everyone, not just me, and that God's act of choosing us is not rooted in our own inherent amazingness. No. And thank God it isn't. Christ is our wisdom, our righteousness, our holiness, and our redemption. We don't have to be everything. God is. And what wonderful humor there is to be found in reading the Apostle Paul here. He goes on to say, he resolved to know nothing but Jesus Christ and him crucified, and he did not come with eloquence or human wisdom. But I mean, read Paul's letters. This is not some uneducated guy who has no idea how to use language. Perhaps because of this, he tells us that God has made foolish the wisdom of the world, that Jesus is the fulfillment of all human yearning for the most wise, the most good, the most holy love. I need these verses every bit as much today as I did when I was a sophomore in college. I probably need them more now that I'm a professor. For the last 12 years, I've worked at Geneva College in Beaver Falls, PA. It's a small Christian school, and though the work there comes with all the usual challenges of a school trying to stay afloat in a world that is less and less hospitable to higher education, I love working there. Most of that love comes from the place that's been created by some dedicated dreamers who teach humanities there. I get to teach the intro course called Invitation to the Humanities, together with professors from different disciplines who formed an unusually close bond with each other. There's a history professor, a philosophy professor, a musicologist, a sociologist, and whatever it is that I am. And we work together with three student TAs, each eating lunch together once a week and meeting again in the late afternoon to share life and discuss ideas that we hope to understand more deeply ourselves, even as we strive to convey them to students. We genuinely hope to extend a real invitation. We say Humanities 103 is a course about life, about the good life. What does it mean to be human? How do we deal with the fact that we are limited, that we are mortal, that we die? How do we learn to love when love collapses all around us and in us? How do we live in community? How can we pursue membership with one another in the body of Christ in an ever-splintering world? How do we pursue a calling when we tend to reduce life to utilitarian, mechanistic categories we don't even realize we are using? We think of this course as a book about life, and the first unit, which we call a chapter, is called Humanities, That's the Adventure. This semester, I had the privilege of giving the adventure lecture, which I've borrowed from a retiring colleague who studied deeply the works of the Inklings, particularly Tolkien and Chesterton. And she concludes that adventure entails the following things. A real adventure involves real peril to body and soul. Real obligations, real prohibitions, real decisions, and real consequences. Any good story has conflict. If there's no problem, there's no story. So the idea of real peril makes sense. There is danger afoot. There are monsters in the forest. There are monsters inside of us. And not only can our bodies be hurt, but our souls can get mangled as well. There are obligations, things we must do. We have people to protect, rings to throw into the fires of Mordor, battles to win, innocent ones to rescue. There are real prohibitions, things we must not do. We must not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Frodo must not put on the one ring. There are real decisions. With every situation, the adventurer must choose this way or that way, who to trust, what ties to break, and every decision comes with consequences, and the quester almost always fails and learns. Not only do we need this lesson on adventure to help us to understand stories that we read in the course, but it's a reminder that we are scripted by stories, the stories we're born into, the stories we're told, the stories we tell. And the more closely we learn to pay attention, even to good fiction, the more we learn to see the stories we are living, their perils, obligations, prohibitions, decisions, and consequences. We are adventurers on a quest. And a vision of the real calls us on adventure, even when we do not know the way. I suppose the part of my life that's a little easier to see as an adventure is my time as a missionary. I spent part of the summers of 1997 and 1999 on mission trips. The first was a college trip with some Robert students to go to Budapest, Hungary. I like to say I was motivated into missions by jealousy. I was waiting and watching all these other people go on trips, and it took me forever to find one that I could go on. And when I finally did, I was thrilled. It was a great first taste of Europe and mission work in the city, but I came back home unsatisfied. What did we do? What did we change? Those kids there still have to wake up, and they still need food and clothes and comfort and a stable home, and they definitely need Jesus, and we couldn't fix it in a week. My second trip in 99 was about the length of the whole summer, and I lived with missionaries and learned what real missionary life was like. By the way, just a few weeks ago, you heard from Jerry Coleman. I call him Jerry Bachi, which means Uncle Jerry, because that's his nickname in Hungary. It was Jerry Coleman's family that took me in the summer of 99. I started out my trip in Győr, Hungary, and watched Jerry's kids and walked their little schnauzer three times a day. It was not a typical mission trip. I got to learn what it's like to just really live somewhere else. Sometimes, sure, you might be preaching or teaching or meeting people's material needs, but sometimes the biggest question on your mind for the day is, where do I get my little dog groomed in this strange city where I don't speak the language? Or when it's my birthday, what restaurant will I go to? Mundane things were part of life, and I learned about the daily struggle to just get up another day and learn something new that feels impossible. Like, call this person you have never met and ask her to help you with A, B, and C. Oh my goodness, this is the worst task you could possibly ask me to do. Make me scrub 300 toilets, ask me to learn Greek on my own, but do not make me call someone. People taught me to call people, to ask for help, to spend time in other people's lives, in other people's living rooms. The longer adventure for me began in May 2000 when I finished my master's degree. I moved to Rivne, Ukraine, one of the places I had served the previous summer, and there was so much to learn. I can still remember riding in the car with Marcy Hewson. At the time, she was a single missionary in her late 30s. She became my boss, my dear friend and mentor. Marcy said, "You are going to make mistakes. Leave it to Marcy to tell me the truth." And she always did. She took care of me. She prodded me. She encouraged me. She laughed with me. She told me her stories. Oh, how I needed that. Not only to survive the change that comes with moving to a new culture, but also in order to accept an invitation, a calling. She always expressed her call to Ukraine as, "I just felt like God was inviting me." It was so helpful for me to have someone who was really real with me, who demystified calling a little bit. Because growing up, I felt like to become a missionary, the heavens had to open and you would hear God's voice, "Go." And Marcy said, "I just felt God inviting me." Which opened the door for me to think, okay, what's God inviting me to do? So I'm pursuing this idea of calling. I'm telling you my story because it's a little bit about my call, which is kind of a murky thing. It's something that's really taken different paths. What is a calling? If you're going to college, this is probably an important question for you, especially if you're, you know, paying for college and you want to know what you're supposed to do. But maybe you just think of it as, "I just want a job, and this calling business is really too spiritual or impractical for me to care about." But if you're someone who believes in a caller, then the idea of a calling comes with it. When Jesus Christ calls a man, he bids him come and die. I first heard this line from Dietrich Bonhoeffer when I was studying at Duquesne University in Pittsburgh. The professors there were reading Bonhoeffer and St. Augustine and Jacques Ellul. It was a great place. But so Bonhoeffer says, "Come and die." Who wants that job offer? But I have to admit, that's kind of what most people think a missionary call is. Give up your selfish dreams and accept God's call to mission. When you're a Protestant, since you can't go off and join a convent, you become a missionary. It's often seen as giving up on the American dream, on a certain form of the good life, on marriage, kids, the car, the house, the dog. Becoming a missionary felt like a way of solving my calling problem. This is why in my notes I titled this message, "The Calling Problem Settled." It's all sorted out. You can't do better. I mean, you could become a pastor, and at least I grew up in a church where I knew that I too could become a pastor, but just try and beat missionary. But then you become a missionary, and you have to figure out how to live with the call. I had to learn a lot. How to grow up, how to be an adult in Ukraine, how to fill my days and be neither too idle nor too manic, to rest and work, to be alone and with people. I worked with 9 different foreign missionaries in my 10 years in Ukraine. Missionary work in Europe was pretty new, and so most of what we did was related to church planting. I taught English and led worship. I had Bible studies for people who weren't Christians yet. It was a wild time of life, but people who weren't believers wanted to come hang out and talk about the Bible. Marcy was right when she said that you will make mistakes. I definitely did. There were failures and disappointments. There were days when it was really hard to figure out how to come back home
and tell people in churches what we were doing because they were expecting to hear stories of just hundreds of conversions. They had that perception that out there on the magical mission field, people are flocking to Jesus. And sometimes, but not always. And Europe was not one of those places where that tended to happen. But it was a good place to be. It was the right place to be at that stage in my life. But in 2010, I moved from Ukraine back to the States because it was time to hand the ministry over to Ukrainians. And we're so thankful because now there is a thriving ministry there, fed by rich partnerships and intensified by the fires of war. When I moved back to the States, I had to re-identify my call. I had to tune it in and hear it again. Suddenly, I was back home, literally living with my parents, sleeping in my childhood bedroom, and no longer a missionary. What was I now? After working the cash register at Lowe's for a few months, I became a teacher, and I love my work. I'm also a worship leader. I've served on some denominational committees and made great friends across the Free Methodist Church. There are plenty of adventures to live, though I'm not always sure what's required of me or which story I am in day to day. The calling problem isn't simple. It doesn't feel settled. But here's what I know. My sense of calling still comes down to things that I learned from my parents first. Love Jesus and put Jesus first. Show up for people when God tells you to. Understand that your worth is not in what you take home in a paycheck, is not in your title or position, is not limited to a particular post. All of these things matter and have their influence on your life. But you cannot steward any of those privileges well if you base your worth on them. They are passing. You are left with the kind of person you have let yourself become. A calling is a pilgrimage in the world, a journey. It is not static, even if you have a much more focused plan than I do, even if you're the kind of person who always knew you wanted to be a teacher, a doctor, an engineer, a social worker, a musician, a programmer, or even a missionary. A calling is an adventure. And a true adventure develops us and moves us toward transformation. We live in a world filled with peril to body and soul, dangers from without and dangers from within. We make real decisions. Those decisions have consequences, and life messes things up. We can get sick. We might not get that job. Someone might wreck us, or we might wreck someone else. We get derailed, and we give up. That country that became my home for 10 years, the country that I love, is at war. A war that really started about 10 years ago but was amplified by Russia's full-scale invasion in the winter of 2022. I'm torn by a desire to be part of that suffering in some kind of fruitful way. I'm not sure what that means. But I'm trying to navigate my pilgrimage in a way that includes heartbreak, prayer, and any action God calls me to. Friends in Ukraine are most certainly on an adventure. True adventurers find themselves in stories they didn't choose, stepping up to the challenges of life. Many who trained to be professionals in other fields have become soldiers, medics, chaplains, counselors. Life demands their answer to the call. And I am so moved watching their service and sacrifice, their intense work of holding on to hope. I have friends here in the States who are getting older or sicker. Mortality nibbles life away, but they are faithfully walking their pilgrimage, and I'm in awe and learning from them. I'm teaching the young, Gen Z, and in some cases, teaching right alongside Gen Z. And I'm in awe of you, too. You were born into this hyper-connected world where you can be everywhere at once, omniscient and omnipresent. But some of you are falling apart under the pressure of knowing too much and living in too many places. We are all living under this pressure, and we're all falling apart. We lose sight of the real. We go deaf to the call. We go numb in the dark. But God has made us with such capacity for goodness, for faithfulness, for life, and for love. We may not always see signs of hope for our generation, but hope restores our sight. Hope in Christ is our vision of the real. This hope is the invisible sign of life from the creator of the universe who promises that he will be with us even to the very end of the age. Jesus, the incarnate one who became flesh and dwelt among us. And here is the great and terrible news. Our calling problem is actually settled. We are all called to carry Christ. The Virgin Mary was called in a particular way, in a specific moment, to carry Jesus, and she answered, "I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said." But now we are all called to carry Christ on earth. A vision of the real calls us on adventure, even when we do not know the way. Jesus told us that he is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the most real one. Christ, the wisdom of God and the power of God. We are called to bear Christ, for as the Apostle Paul wrote in Colossians 1, the glorious riches of this mystery is this, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Durbin. Through this semester, and really through this year, my hope in thinking about this theme called to more is that you would specifically be inspired to think about how you will make a difference in this world. No matter what career you pursue here, whatever degree, but that how you are going to make a difference, how you would be transformed, and how God will transform the world through you. Thank you, Dr. Durbin, for calling us to that same inspiration of thinking about how God is calling us. Have a great day. You're dismissed.